I'd like to welcome everyone to the Civic Camp Citizens Forum for Public School Board Trustees, Wards 12 and 14, and 11 and 13. Thank you very much for attending tonight and showing your interest in issues that affect our city, and in particular affect the education of our children. My name's Jeff Bowes. I'm the president of the Calgary Association of Parents and School Councils, and I'll be your moderator tonight. For those of you who aren't familiar with Civic Camp is a non-partisan public advocacy group enabling citizens to engage in creating a city that works for all of us. Any Calgarian is welcome to become a member or to become a Civic Camper by visiting civiccamp.org and learning more about the organization and what values Civic Campers have set out for themselves, and join up with a group that interests them. One of those groups is the Election Initiatives Group, and this is the group that decided a great way to raise public awareness of civic issues would be to have election forms for the civic elections and now the public school board trustee elections. So before I go further, there's some thanks I have to make. So first of all the Civic Camp volunteers who helped make tonight happen, can't happen without them. A number of sponsors have generously donated their time and service as well. Some of their logos are on the sign in front of us. We'd like to thank our host, the Lake Bonavista Community Association, for lending us their facility tonight. Also, Calgary Sound Rentals and Calgary Road Runners for providing equipment at significantly reduced rates. Also, CBC Calgary, CJSW, Fast Forward Weekly, and Metro Calgary for helping to get the word out about the forums. Thanks to, I guess, my organization, the Calgary Association of Parents and School Councils, and also the Alberta Teachers Association for their support for these events, in particular the School Board Trustee Forums. Another thanks to the students' associations at Mount Royal University and the University of Calgary Students Union, who have provided facilities for Ward 11, Ward 1, and the Mayor's Citizen Forum. Finally, the Calgary Foundation for help paying some of the bills. And finally, thank you all for taking an interest in coming out tonight. Okay, so I'd like to start by going over the ground rules. So, Civic Campers have named these forums the Citizens Forums, and this is because the questions, at least half the questions, come from what Calgarians have chosen on a website that allows people to submit questions and vote them up. So during the first half of tonight's forum, those questions will all come from that website and be given in the order of popularity that Calgarians chose for them. Civic Camps, excuse me a minute. So, as I said, the top voting questions will be what we'll ask, and here's how the format tonight will work. Each candidate will be asked two questions and will be provided 1.5 minutes to respond. In the interest of time and asking as many questions as possible, only two candidates will respond to each question. They'll be selected randomly. The candidates that will be asked to respond to each question will be drawn randomly. Sorry, that's what I just said. Because we can't have every candidate answer every question, we want to provide the opportunity for each candidate to answer two questions that are not asked directly of them. So once candidates have answered the question, I will ask if anyone else would like to respond. At that time, any candidate can cash in one of their two coins. So each candidate can choose to answer two questions that they weren't called upon. These coins are in the glass in front of you. Or just put them in, show me the coin and put them in the glass in front of you. To ensure we ask some more ward-specific questions as well, everyone in the audience has been provided with cards when you entered tonight. Have cards been passed out?
No.
Okay, so cards will be passed out. If you think of a question any time during the forum, just put up your hand and one of the Tara or Nancy will come and pass out a card to you. You can also fill out the cards during intermission, but if you think of the questions in advance, we'd appreciate it if you'd put those questions down during the first part of the debate. Working with me tonight are Tara, our chief logistics person for tonight, and Nancy, and was Wendy here? Okay, she's gone. We had one other person who's gone already. Okay, on that note, I'd like to remind everyone of the etiquette. Okay, so the first thing is please respect the clock. The base questions are 1 minute and 30 seconds. That applies to both the audience questions and the crowdsource questions. Your rebuttals for the two poker chips are 1 minute apiece, so you have 1 minute for those questions. And there also is a how round in the second half, where I'll ask each of you a question quickly about your platform, and you will have 30 seconds to respond as to how you will implement that. Okay. Next, please make it easy for the audience to listen, so don't interrupt other candidates as they speak. Please stay issue focused. This isn't a debate, so we don't have specific references to any of our opponents or incumbents or anything of that nature. And one thing we'd like the audience to decide, so we've asked everyone leave their campaign materials outside. We welcome applause and such, but we do not welcome any booing or anything that interferes with any other candidates. Also, please use your applause in a way that does not interfere with another candidate's answer. Okay, so that wraps that long prelude up. So next, I'd like to do the introduction. So each candidate will now have 2 minutes to introduce themselves and tell a little bit about their platform. So we'll start with Amber on my right here.
Look at that. What did I do to get to go first? And there's a clock there. I'm sorry, can everybody hear me? I'm a runner, so I'm always fighting against the clock. So anyway, hi everyone. My name is Amber Stewart. I am a mother of three. I have a degree in sociology, and I have a background in office management. I have had the opportunity to work in administration at the University of Calgary. I have reported to a board of directors within the nonprofit sector, and I have also worked in the accounting department within the seniors housing industry. In my community, I am a proud vice president of my local community association. I sit on the executive at my children's school council, and for the past 4 years, I have been one of the league organizers for our local Timbit Soccer League. I am asking to represent Wards 12 and 14 because I feel that education is important. It is one of the cornerstones of a great society. And as a parent, I feel that I really have a vested interest in the future of education. I care very deeply about this community, and I am prepared to advocate for our children. I believe that I bring a well-rounded experience. And most of all, I bring the passion and energy and desire needed to do this job. Thank you all for being here. It shows that you're engaged and just happy to see you all here. Thank you.
Okay, next, Christina Steed.
Excellent, it's a pleasure to be here. My name is Christina Steed. I am a resident of Ward 14 and have been so for the past 11 years. I also am a mother. I have four children ranging in age from 14 down to 6. I have a degree in political science and history with distinction from the University of Calgary. For the past 3 years, I've been working as an MLA assistant to Cindy Eady first and now to the Minister of Justice, Jonathan Dennis. In that capacity, I continually advocate daily for individuals within the system and how to navigate within the bureaucracy of the government. In this capacity, our office is completely nonpartisan and we help everyone who walks through the door, and it's been a real pleasure. I also am involved in our community. I have sat on my kids' parent councils. I have helped out at our community association, and I've been a long-term volunteer with the YMCA. It's through my volunteering at the YMCA, actually, that I've had some of my most, my touching moments, I must say. In that capacity, I've helped the LINK program raise books and donations for new immigrants to Calgary, and also was privileged to receive their Volunteer of the Year award in 2007. I would love the opportunity to represent you in Wards 12 and 14 as a public trustee. I think with education, it is the cornerstone of a great society. It is the second largest expenditure of the provincial budget, so really all of us are invested in making a great education system work, regardless of whether or not we have children currently in it. All of us make for a better society when our children are educated. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Christina. All right, next, Todd Neuman.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming out. My name is Todd Neuman, and I'm happy to be out here on the trail for public trustee. My background, I am happily married for 21 years, mostly happily. I have two kids, 13 and 11, attending Calgary Middle School in the public system, in the Spanish program. Fantastic program. I'm a huge supporter of the schools. I have a business background. I'm a small business owner, running my own company full-time since 1999. It's given me a lot of exposure to solving small problems and solving the big problems too. We're used to balancing budgets, making things run, and spending wisely. It would be the biggest thing to do for me is to represent our kids. They're our biggest asset, they're our strongest thing, and we love them dearly. It's our job to educate them, they're our future. Everything we're gonna do is gonna hinge on them, where they go, where they land. We don't even know what problems they're gonna see as adults, and we have to prepare them today for something we don't know what's coming tomorrow. I would appreciate the opportunity to represent your views. I would love to hear from each and every one about what they think should be in public education, and I'd like to put the public back in public education. Thank you.
Thank you, Todd. All right, next, Helen Mowat.
Good evening. I'm Helen Mowat, your only representative for the public school trustee. I have chosen my words carefully. If you want common sense and transformational change, then I am your only representative. If you want more of the same or even worse, then there are plenty of people who love playing the game and being part of the charade. They haven't done the work they need to do. I'm not your status quo or mediocre person. I care. I am real, and I am conscious, and I want a conscious civilization or society of higher education. And it won't come from our universities or by individuals. But by individuals who really care. I was a dedicated grade 4 classroom teacher. Today, my audience is much larger. It is worldwide. I'm concerned how the citizens have been deliberately excluded from the early planning stages. This is a planned agenda by the elite of this world, thereby leaving us in the dark as to what the end game is going to be. I prefer to work in the light rather than darkness. The best way to clean a dark room is to open the window and allow the light in. My website will be up for 3 years, and there will be a full-length movie called State of Mind, and a whole list of alternative websites so you can discover for your own truth about the education system and, of course, go beyond. For over 15 plus years, I taught elementary school children. My approach to teaching and learning was integrative, holistic, and real. I loved instilling capacity, confidence, and initiative into the hearts and minds of our most innocent children.
Thank you, Helen. I think we'll move on to Greg Humphreys at this moment.
Good. Evening, ladies and gentlemen. Not too much trouble. I have a problem answering questions or talking sitting down. So if it's all right with you, I'm going to stand up and do this. Firstly, I'd like to thank you for having us. And to the folks that are here, I think that you have a very good slate of candidates in front of you, and you're actually very fortunate over that of a number of the other wards that have a limited number of folks running. So you've got a real good selection base to draw upon. Many of you may know me. I have been the president twice of the Willow Ridge Community Association, immediately to the north of us. I have been on the Taxi Commission. I sit as a board director on a children's school for disabled children. And I've been an active volunteer of the Stampede and other organizations for over 30 years. I've also lived in this community for 30 years. Be that as it may, it's all written down. It's on a little leaflet outside. You can read it another time. Reason that I am here is that I believe the school board requires a bit of a wake-up call. And there's a number of you in the audience that know I have a good record of giving very bad wake-up calls to people that need it. There is a decided lacking of transparency in the school board. There is a number of issues that I think have gone unrecorded, unasked, that need to be brought forward. The one that I can think of easiest is what I'll call option 6. You all heard about option 5, $52 million going someplace else. Well, option 6 should have been to the school board. Option 6, that money came from your pockets anyway. If you remember way back when, it used to come from your taxes that were based
Thank you very much, Greg.
On the school board. Thanks very much.
Okay, next. Malik Amery.
Thank you.
No, it's okay.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Malik Amery. I'm running again. I ran last election, wards 12 and 14, and I'm back again primarily because many of the issues and concerns are still prevalent, and in some cases even worse. I am married, and I have a beautiful son. He's in the back there. I'm a born and raised Calgarian. I'm a product of the CB. I've gone through the system. I'm a University of Calgary graduate. I have degrees in both economics and accounting, and I'm also a certified managerial accountant by trade. I work in corporate finance, and I also volunteer. I've sat on a board of directors for Mackenzie Town Council for 4 years, where I hold the roles of treasurer, HR chair, and also I work with our Plaza Committee as co-chair. I'm basically running in order to perhaps put a more medium behind the words accountability and transparency. Ultimately, it seems they've been used more and more so as political catchphrases rather than what they actually mean, and solutions and recommendations on how to actually produce accountability and transparency and move towards that particular mantra, which is extremely important. At the end of it all, my thought is that basically, as a candidate, I serve the people. I sit as an advocate, and it's my job to engage the stakeholders, find out what the issues and concerns are, and ultimately to relay them to the province and, of course, to the board in order to ensure not only that they're understood, but ultimately that solutions are put forward and recommendations are put forward. As a candidate, my hope is, of course, to continue or re-engage, not continue, the stakeholders, and ultimately come up with additional resources for the classrooms, because inherently I think that's why all of us are here, is to get more resources into the classrooms for the children. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Malik. Okay, before we move on, I just want to clarify one thing. So the 6 candidates from which you just heard from, the ones with the yellow-colored signs in front of them on the tables, they're the candidates for Ward 12 and 14. So the next two candidates, Sheila Taylor and Randy Sweet, are the candidates for Wards 11 and 13. So we'll start with Randy Sweet.
I forgot something in my bag. Can I go get it?
What do you need in your bag? Could someone run and grab her a bag while someone's...
I can't remember. I don't know, but thank you. Thank you.
Sorry, Randy, would you like to go ahead?
Good evening, everyone. Thank you so very much for coming out. My name is Randy Sweet. I was born in Calgary 55 years ago. I was through the school system as well, and I live now in Meadowlark Park, which is in Ward 11. I have 2 children that go to school at Alboya School, and over the past while, I have been very active in their school, helping out, and I just thought I wouldn't mind giving back a little bit. I have a degree in education, I have a degree in sociology, and I have a diploma in business administration with a management major. I have taught in 3 different countries, and I've worked in the oil patch all around the world. I bring a unique worldview, I think, to this discussion and to this potential trustee candidacy. Thank you very much. I really hope to hear from some of you with your concerns.
Thank you very much, Randy. Next, Sheila Taylor.
Sorry, it's not long enough.
Good intentions, Karen.
The other day I was out door knocking in a local community and I wound up having a very lengthy discussion, you could say a frank discussion, with a concerned local mother about a lot of her concerns around her community, around communications, around how to make our neighborhoods a better place to be. And I recall at the end of the conversation, she said to me, "You know the best thing about public education? It's for everyone." And I think that really sums it all up for me. The reason that I'm here today running for re-election is because I think a great public education system is the heart of an amazing city. My name is Sheila Taylor. I'm currently trustee for wards 11 and 13 in Southwest Calgary. I'm seeking re-election, and I hope that the job that I have done over the past 3 years gives the public confidence in my ability to move forward as a leader of our school system. I'm a mother of two children in elementary school, an active community member. As I sit here, I'm looking at a young man who I coached basketball last year. A very talented young man, I have to say. I'm sitting in a gym that I've often been in at community association meetings. I've served on the board here for 4 years, currently the vice president of community affairs for this community, and I expect to become president of this community association tomorrow night. I've worked hard on the board being a voice of accountability, of transparency, of responsiveness to community members. I hope that the public will consider re-electing me for a second term. It's been my honor to serve you, to ensure we have schools we all can be proud of. An education system that truly is for everyone.
Thank you, Sheila. So again, a reminder that Randy and Sheila with the green signs are the candidates for Ward 11 and 13. So we'll now move on to the first round of crowdsourced questions. As I said, there will be two rounds, so each candidate will receive two questions. You will have a minute and 30 seconds to answer those questions. Two candidates will answer each question. After the two candidates answer the question that's been directed at them, I will choose the candidates at random by pulling chips with the names on them from this cup. I will ask if anyone would like to use their poker chip to answer the question who did not answer it, or if they want to add to their answer or anything like that. So I guess we will begin that round. So the first question goes to Greg and Malik, and the question is, and we're doing these in the order of popularity that they were voted on the crowdsourcing site. So the most popular question was, would you support a policy that gives siblings first priority in the schools that must use a lottery for admittance? Why or why not? Greg, first, please.
My answer would be a qualified yes. I understand it's qualified. Two reasons. One, I don't necessarily know all the facts, so I'm giving you a uninformed opinion because I haven't been privy to the decisions that have been used up to this point. However, that said, I look at things from a black and white dollars and cents point of view, and it just makes sense to have two children delivered to the same school rather than having two children delivered to alternate schools because nowadays more and more regrettably we are using busing. Additionally, the older sibling can often as not provide some guidance to the younger sibling, hence also relieving some of the supervision requirements that are used by the teachers in the schools. I think it's a black and white thing, not necessarily married to it, but that's my first answer.
Start?
Yes.
Oh, thank you. For me, it would have to be, and I understand this is a supply and demand issue in terms of accessibility to students in particular areas, and that's why it becomes contentious. If there were sufficient schools and room, then this wouldn't even be a question. I would support it primarily for, first and foremost, the Student Sibling Association, that support network. It's imperative. I went to school with my brother, my sister followed suit, and there's just this, if you will, hierarchy of associating them with the school, making them feel comfortable, making them get kind of integrated within the school system. The second part is from, I guess, the logistics aspect of the family. Inherently, if siblings are split up, that becomes very troublesome for families with one particular student in one school and one in the other. That sometimes leads to excessive busing. Sometimes that has a younger student on a bus inherently because the parents don't have access or the ability to drive their children to school. And I'm comfortable with the siblings' first priority, primarily because it also, not primarily, but it also mirrors certain universities, if you will, and the fact that typically universities grant access to students which have graduates or parents or siblings or grandparents. So it kind of follows suit in that idea. Now, the public school system isn't intended to follow the university mantra, but given the fact that there's imperative consequences on the actual siblings and the children and their educational experience, I think it's important to keep the siblings together and support the family.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Does anyone wish to use their poker chips on this question? All right, the next question is for Helen and Amber. And that question is, what could the school board do to address schools with not enough students and communities with no schools? Helen. Helen?
Okay, repeat that again, please.
Sure. What could the school board do to address schools with not enough students and communities with no schools?
Definitely communities that have no schools, we need strong families and we need a strong hub. And that means our provincial government building our schools for us. I don't believe in P3s because it's extra tax money. We have enough money. This province is rich. The country in Canada is rich. And if we as Canadians spend our money wisely, on my website there's going to be a list of resources and you'll see a retired teacher who now lives in BC and is saying that we wouldn't even have to pay taxes because we have so much, many resources in Canada. But these resources go to the wrong people. So, one, we have to be accountable and not use it as just a little mantra, what most people, all the politicians say. I'm not a politician. You're accountable for what happens, whether it be building a school or how to educate students properly. Not dogma or indoctrination, but you're responsible as a trustee and as a parent to become knowledgeable as what is happening. With our children, it's deplorable. When we have so much potential, and we put such limits on them.
Thank you very much, Helen.
Thank you.
Amber?
Hi there. Okay, so whenever we start to talk about the question of not enough schools, people talk, they get worried about school closures. So let's be clear right from the start, we're not talking about school closures here. We have more students than what it seems our schools can handle. So what we need to look at and start thinking about is accommodation and where we're putting our students. What I would like to suggest and put forward is that we start to think a little bit out of the box. And I know that's a cliche, I'm sorry. And we start to think about how to solve this problem. One of the ideas that I would suggest is that we have another look at our school boundaries. At this point in time, part of our crunch and why we have students on the bus for so long is that we're trying to accommodate very large communities, such as Auburn Bay, in an entire school together. I've been in Auburn Bay knocking doors, and on one street alone, there was a student that went to the Catholic school, private school, charter school, and homeschool. So this idea that we all grew up with, that an entire community all attends the same school, doesn't apply in new communities that don't have schools yet. So I'd like to suggest that we at least have a look at maybe splitting up that school so that we can accommodate, splitting up that community, maybe having a north section, a south section, so that we can then make a trade and make bus rides shorter for everyone, accommodate everyone a little closer to home. Let's at least open the discussion. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Amber. Would anyone else like to weigh in on this issue? All right, thank you. So the next question, we'll go to Randy and Christina. So that question is, recent budget constraints have challenged fine arts education programs. What steps would you take to address this need? Randy?
Thank you. This is a really very, very serious situation, I feel. My daughter in grade 5 wasn't able to take fine arts classes of any kind at school. So we investigated what the City of Calgary programs had to offer, and third-party dance studios and all different kinds of things. And we were able to supplement her education that way. And for those that have an issue with being able to pay for these, I discovered that the City of Calgary have a fee assistance program. You apply for the fee assistance, and you can take these programs at a significantly reduced rate, up to 90% in some cases. It also allows you to use the leisure centers and all of the things that the City of Calgary have to offer. So even though I would like to see the schools get more involved in the fine arts, I believe that there is an alternative, and it's a usable, workable alternative. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Randy. Christina?
First and foremost, I believe fine arts are a hallmark of why some children actually stay in school. It is the bedrock. If you look around us and everything we do, we're surrounded by fine arts. At the office, when Mount Royal went through their cuts of the jazz program, that was one of the, I would say, the top five issues that we received emails on in the past 3 years that I've been working. It's crucial. It's one of those things that the heart of everyone, you know, speaks to. It surrounds us visually, musically, everything. So I think that as a society, we need to look at how we value fine arts and why it's important, and it allows our children to critically think in a different way. And as a society, if we value it, then we should support it. Things that I would like to see happen is more of a collaborative approach. Maybe perhaps partnering, CBE could partner with more with other groups within the city that would help, I know, come into the classroom. I know with my children's school, the parent group supports bringing in organizations such as Three Left Feet, so that children who may not have an opportunity to experience that in their own home, they can experience it in the classroom. Now, I know that this doesn't happen in every school situation, so I think that we should support that as the public.
Thank you very much. Would anyone else like to go ahead, Malik?
I don't have a cup.
You want that ding sound.
I believe the fine arts program inherently makes a part of the fabric of the education process. And ultimately, if I understood the question, we're looking for solutions to ultimately alleviate the fact that there's erratic funding and the fact that basically there's limited resources to such an important part of the education process for students. One suggestion I had, it's kind of outside the box, would be ultimately a centralized specialty program or specialty schools in specific quadrants of the city. Now, inherently, that might add some additional busing, but at the same time, it allows for economies of scale, specialization, and ultimately would allow the expertise to be centralized in certain quadrants and would give them the most opportunity and the best advantages of the fine arts program. And it would ultimately have sustainability in the long run, considering that there's funding issues and issues with resources and limitations. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Malik. You want to use a chip? Helen.
I was a teacher that brought in fine arts to the Calgary Board of Education. It was called the Art Project, I think it was. I forget which one we chose. I was one of 8 or 9 people in the City of Calgary. It is obvious that people here do not understand the power of the mind and the mind-body-soul connection and how important integration is, as well integration is to your different lessons. And sadly to say, when we compartmentalize everything, we haven't got a clue what reality is. We can't explore the truth. And our children just go along to get along with the crowd. And so art is very, very important. And it is important that each teacher knows about art and that in each course it is represented in the subjects. Not just drawing little pictures.
Thank you very much, Helen.
It's creating connections.
Anyone else want to add in on the arts? Okay. So the final question in this round goes to Todd and Sheila. So that question is, do you believe it is important to have more board members with education backgrounds? Todd.
Not necessarily. I think an education background is beneficial, but I think a passion for children is the most important part. Everybody, it's the beauty of a democracy. Everybody has an opinion, and everybody, we're bright, we're intelligent people. We all have something to contribute. Everybody has strengths, and if it was a case that the board was run purely by people from an educational perspective, it may lose some of the real world perspective that we can bring to the table. Myself, as a business operator, owner and operator, I learned challenges of operating business, or operating the business, keeping customers happy, making sure that revenue is coming in and out the door. We need to learn to spend our money wisely. We balance risk versus reward. We know we have to spend money in order to get the benefit. If we don't take that chance, we want to take smart chances.
Thank you very much, Todd. Sheila.
I fundamentally believe that the best decisions come when you have a variety of viewpoints at the table, a variety of perspectives and backgrounds. And that is how a great board makes decisions. I remember visiting the school board in 2010 when I was considering running and looking up at the board table and thinking, I didn't see any parents sitting at that table. I didn't see any people that looked like they represented me as a parent, as a business person, as an active community member. That was one of the big reasons back in 2010 that I wanted to run. I wanted to bring community voice to the table. As I see it on the board right now, we have a mixture of people with all sorts of backgrounds, from business to education, all across the board. And that's what we need to continue to have on the school board, a variety of perspectives. But the bottom line is what we need is people who are willing to listen to their communities, to ask the questions that need asking, and to be open and accountable to the public.
Thank you very much, Sheila. Anyone wish to add on this topic? Okay, so that ends our first round of questioning. We'll now move on to the second round of questions. So the first question we had a bit of a debate about. The question is not directly within the jurisdiction of school board trustees, but was the fifth most popular question on the site, and we do want to stick with what the citizens are telling us to ask, and they are interested in what your opinions are on this issue and how you'd advocate it for it. So the question is, and I'll first say who this is going to go to. This will go to Greg and Malik. The question is, do you favor taxpayer support for charter or religiously based schools? Why or why not? Greg.
No. Simple as that. I do not believe that taxpayers' money should be used in this fashion. Now, understand me, I'm not talking about immersion courses or things of this nature. What we're talking about is a separation of schools based often as not on a cultural basis. I have a belief, some will disagree, but I'll tell you right now, multiculturalism in Canada has not succeeded well. In fact, some will say it's been a failure. Multiculturalism has orchestrated separation rather than joining together of cultures. And I believe that to take and embrace that by separating schools into ethnic groups, cultural groups, religious groups, is fundamentally wrong because it erodes the fabric for which this country, this city, is a perfect example of a city that should be, but I believe that in the long term, it's not the right way to go. That said, I believe you can also achieve the goals that might be wished by embracing some of the aspects that different cultures, religions, and like bring to our, you know, community party. And this can be done within the classroom, but it doesn't have to be separate classrooms. Thank you.
Thank you, Greg. Malik.
I think when you look at it, you have to take a more holistic approach on what the actual issue is. Inherently, taxpayer dollars come from every household. A portion of the actual education budget is made up from your property taxes, and a portion is made up primarily of government revenues. Inherently, it's the Alberta people that contribute to the funding of the education system. While at the end of the day, I don't favor the allocation of public dollars into charter religious schools, inherently, there are certain issues that come paramount to what's going on. And inherently, at the end of the day, it's educating children. Now, as long as education is equitable, being between the religious and charter schools and the public system, then there really isn't an issue to me. And if there was adequate funding, this wouldn't have been one of the top five questions. The problem is erratic funding. So you have to assess, let's look at the actual education that they are receiving. Is it equitable? If it's not equitable, then the funding formula from the provincial government needs to be adjusted to ensure, at a minimum, that the public system is equitable to these charter and religious schools which receive taxpayer dollars. The argument to say, no, I wouldn't exclusively, becomes contentious because ultimately, these people that have children attending these schools pay their property taxes and contribute to government revenues. So you can't unequivocally say no. You do have to, however, ensure that it's equitable. If the charter schools and the religious schools become advantaged over the public school children, well then again, it's up to the province to make it right. Currently, right now, the charter and the religious schools receive less dollars per student than does a student attending the public system. It's about a $2,000 variance in the elementary, junior high, high school realm, and it actually the variance grows. And I'm fine with that. Now, if it's a limited resources, then ultimately the province will have to tear down how much money they allocate to the religious and private school, religious and charter schools, and make it right and equitable. Thank you.
All right. So next question, we'll go to Helen and Todd. And that question is, what is the biggest challenge facing the Calgary Board of Education, and what would you do about it? Helen. Helen?
Yeah, I...
Appearance.
Okay. Biggest challenge. Well, the structure needs to be improved. The top-down approach is not working. Parents are not listened to. Students aren't respected. Teachers are not respected. There are so many policies and regulations that teachers are confused. I spoke to somebody tonight just in the hallway. She was a teacher for 15 years. Many excellent teachers are leaving because they're on stress or sick because the system has never been there for the students, has never been there for the public. It's basically we're working as slaves for the elite and the corporations that run this world, rather than serving the needs of our students. What would I do about it? I'd speak again about it. Rather than keeping in silence, I would communicate to the people, and on my website, communicate to the people how it really started. It's been going on for a long time, for centuries. And it's time we all woke up to the fraud and the corruption and the evilness that is out there. Instead of creating misery in our children, we should create well-being and real education.
Thank you very much, Helen. Todd?
I believe the biggest challenge facing Calgary Board of Education today is the funding model that they receive their monies from the Alberta Education based on. That model was redesigned and taken away from the tax rates of the local citizenry and moved to a provincial distribution model. What it did is rebalance from rural school boards that were limited on funding and had limited tax base, and pulled from the larger cities that were supposed to get an economy of scale. What it fails to take into account, and this is where it's our biggest problem, is we don't have enough schools. The only way we can change the amount of schools is we need something to change within the Alberta education formulas, and that's where I'd like to work with Alberta Ed to take into account that our cities have, our major metropolitan cities have a significant population rate increase way above what the rules are. It's creating undue pressure where Calgary Board is not able to take advantage of the economy of scale because the scale is getting weighed down with more and more students, which they dearly do want to take care of, but it's getting weighed more and more down, and the formula just doesn't take that into account as it's in place today. What I'd like to do is work with Alberta Education to enhance the model that they've got so that it is more equitable and more accountable towards a significant population increase that we're currently going through, and it's not slowing down.
Thank you very much, Todd. I believe I saw Sheila and Randy, is that order correct? And then Amber, and then Christina. So we'll start with you, Sheila.
We all want to talk about money. One out of every four students in Calgary does not graduate high school in 3 years. This is something I talk to folks a lot about as I'm out campaigning, and I don't think that I've spoken to a single person who hasn't been very shocked by that number. Now, we live in an amazing city, a prosperous city, and so when you think about all of these students not finishing school, I think it's nothing short of a tragedy. When we look at the question, what's the biggest challenge facing the school system, I think the biggest challenge is ensuring more students finish school. The United Way recently studied this issue and revealed many of the social and economic costs that come from not completing school. But mostly it means that kids, young adults, don't have the opportunities that they would have. What would I do about this? I think there's a lot of little things we can do and a lot of big things. It starts with better early intervention programs for students who are at risk of not finishing school.
Thank you, Sheila. Okay, Randy.
I feel the biggest challenge for our school board coming up is preparing for the future. I think the future is bright, wonderful, and spectacular, because I believe we will be looking at online school and delivery systems that will allow us to take a look at all of the problems for funding that we have now, not enough schools, busing concerns, and we'll begin to address those in a way that is financially responsible. There are schools and school districts in the United States that have internet schooling for elementary kids. We should really be looking at what they're doing, study it, and see if we can't bring that to Alberta. I believe that's the future. High technology, we have to keep that in the schools as well. And just, we can solve our problems with the internet using it properly.
Thank you, Randy. Amber?
So I also, like Todd echoed, think that one of the biggest issues facing the Board of Education is reduced funding. We see this in the lack of new schools, we see this in capital projects that are needed, and most importantly, we see this in the per student funding. So rather than look at the province end of it, let's look at what we can do today at the board level. First thing we can do is show that we're responsible with what we have. Let's get more transparency in the budget. Let's see where we can get more detail to find efficiencies. And when we have searched every efficiency that we can, then we can respectfully advocate to the province with specific detail exactly where we need the money, why we need it, and how we need it. Then we can hopefully start to move forward in a more, what's the word I'm looking for, sustainable funding model. Thank you.
Thank you, Amber. Christina?
Excellent. I'd like to echo some of the things that my colleagues have said here, but I do feel like the fundamental reason is a breakdown in communication and trust. with that communication and trust, not only with the general public at large, but with parents and with students even within the system. Why do we have 1 in 4 not graduating? It's because there is a lack of communication and trust, because they feel like, for whatever reason, they can't trust being at school anymore. They're not getting their needs met, and so therefore they leave. If we have that communication with parents, so that parents actually know what's going on in the classroom, the board is able to effectively communicate what they're doing. And I think if we do that, then there'll be a greater level of trust, not only with the provincial government too, because there is that imbalance currently. One thing that could be happening is with the board meeting minutes, there could be an executive summary after every meeting right on the home page. Thank you.
Thank you, Christina. Okay, next question goes to Randy and Christina. That question is, what will you do to ensure the school board trustees' decisions are more transparent? Randy.
I'm really okay with anything suggested to bring transparency to the school board. If people would like to sit in on the meetings, that's awesome. If the minutes are to be published and put out, if it's to be televised, I can't see why in any way, shape, or form anybody would be for a secrecy in this particular issue. Every decision, everybody should be held accountable for how they voted, how they thought through the process, how the decisions were made in chambers. And I won't need another minute and 12 seconds.
Okay, next, Christina.
Well, currently, the trustee meetings are at 3 o'clock on a Tuesday. For most people, this is an extremely difficult time to attend. If you are a stay-at-home parent, you are getting your kids off the bus, you're picking them up from school, you cannot be there at 3 o'clock. If you're at work, you are at work. So even though that these meetings are webcast and that you can watch them later in their entirety, it's difficult because as you get home, you make dinner, you get your kids to lessons. Frankly, there isn't the time to watch it for 2 to 3 hours later on that night. Like I indicated, I think an executive summary after each can be a page, 2 pages, could go right on the front page of the board's website, and can also be emailed and distributed out through the various communication mediums at the schools. We give our emails to the schools. I know with my kids' schools, I get an email when the newsletter goes out and it's published there online. And I think that is a more effective way to engage and let everybody know exactly what's going on so that they feel connected and communicated with. I think this is one thing that could be done. I think the other thing too is that we make sure we publish all of the documents that we have said we're going to publish in a timely manner. That is, of course, in accordance with the expense reports, that if we publish them when we say we're going to publish them, then I think it gives that sense of credibility to the fact that we are owning up to what we say we're going to own up to. Thank you.
All right. Okay. So, Malik. So first, Sheila had indicated she wanted to talk on this.
So if we're talking about transparency, I'm probably going to need about a half an hour. But I'll try to keep it to a short time. So I think there are many ways that we can improve the transparency of board meetings. They are not transparent currently. This is what I've been saying for years. It starts with having very strict rules around what goes on in camera. It starts with making sure only land, labor, and legal discussions are held behind closed doors. Trustees need to be encouraged to raise issues in public and ask tough questions that will be controversial, that will make the news. That is the job of an elected official. The topics of in-camera meetings need to be published and available, and there needs to be a proper record of in-camera decisions. Proactive disclosure of information at the school board needs to become a very big priority. But number one is electing people that believe in transparency and openness.
Thank you, Sheila. Okay, next was Todd, I believe you put up your...
Yes, I did.
And then Malik. Todd had already indicated.
My approach to transparency comes twofold. Number one, the board has famous in-private meetings where certain controversial decisions are just released. They're decided and released and not necessarily debated in any kind of public forum. As a public education system, I have a problem with it. If it's controversial, it means it should be discussed. It can still be the right decision to do. I'm not saying what they did was the wrong decision. It should be vetted out in the public. The second part that I would do as this approach is I believe and I would commit myself where when a motion is made, passed, I believe that becomes or should become public record, should be posted on websites, on transcripts, but I believe what should accompany it is how the trustees voted so that you as a ward public that has sent that representative there, you have the ability to see that that representative, if they made the right call, they should be willing to stand behind it.
Okay, thank you. Malik?
For me, it starts off with timeliness of information, disclosure of expenses. If money's being spent in August and not disclosed until March, that's a big problem. The second thing would be advanced disclosure of expenses or known expenses to avoid the expensive dinners or the trips that all of a sudden appear many months down the road. Another thing to enhance transparency, internal audit, a committee that's basically composed of not just trustees and CB officials, but also the general public that adds that third party double check, if you will. I would look at defined approval procedures for expenses, basically defining who's responsible to approve specific roles. And also you would want to incorporate inherently additional authorization over a certain threshold. So say anything over $2,000 would require additional authorization. And then again, specific criteria denoting what constitutes being in camera, so the public understands what these certain concerns would have to be, or are in camera, and those topics should be made public.
Thank you very much, Malik.
Thank you.
Did anyone else want to speak on this issue? Helen.
I've attended Calgary Board of Education meetings probably for close to 7 years. I see little or no transparency or accountability. I've seen in June, I've had somebody tell me that 300 teachers flew up to Edmonton via jet up to for a conference, and then comes back, they have to come back by jet, and of course, wine and dine there, and then the principals have to tell the teachers that so many teachers have to go because of budget cuts. This is hocus pocus. I'm sorry. I could never. I would always stand up to truth. The same thing with the building downtown.
Thank you, Helen.
A beautiful building downtown, and it's now all rented.
Thank you.
For the next 20, 30 years.
Did anyone else want to speak on this? Okay, so the final question before intermission is going to go to Sheila and Amber, and that question is, how can the provision of public schools and neighborhood services be better integrated? Sheila.
So I think the job of any elected official is to be good at working with people. And I think that's key. It's about working with your communities, working with the public, but also about working with different branches of government. We need better, more cooperative relationships with both the City of Calgary and the province of Alberta. We hear a lot from the Minister of Education that the future of education, the future of new schools and infrastructure development is going to be very much dependent on how good we are at working with our local business community, at working with our cities, at working with partnerships to bring our schools together in hubs. And this is truly the way that I see the future of our system going. You know, we look at new school construction right now, for example, and we build one little elementary school on one site all by itself and in a big field. And you really have to ask yourself the question, why does it have to be by itself in a field? Why aren't we integrating with other services, recreation, senior services, all together in one place? To make a better community stronger, working together.
Thank you, Sheila. Amber?
have to follow Sheila on that one. All right, so yeah, this is really, I think this is a great issue for wards 12 and 14, especially because we have ward 12 with, you know, sort of a limited number of schools, and we have ward 14 that has quite a number of schools. And you really see a difference between walking around in Ward 12, where there's the limited number of schools, and people are complaining, there's no heart to our community, there's no hub, there's no touchstone for us. And in 14, you see the other side of it in terms of, we'd like more community support, more community integration. I think we have a fantastic opportunity here as the Board of Education to answer that question about what do we do with schools in aging communities. We integrate services. We help keep that established hub of a community, that heart of the community, thriving and going. It's already there in place. Why not utilize it and make a great partnership out of it? In our communities that don't have schools, I think we can help work to foster that within whatever school those students attend, and just, you know, work with community associations, work with community partners to keep that heart in place. Thank you.
Thank you, Amber. Anyone else? Okay, Todd.
This is a particular area I think we really need to look at what the Calgary Separate School Division has done. I think an amazing success was done with the Shaughnessy Y, an integration with Bishop O'Byrne High School. It's a wonderful blended facility with YMCA having all the recreation facilities, Calgary Public Library supplies the library, which incidentally doesn't get a ton of funding from Alberta Education. You get the library, but not the books. And then the school. As I understand it, the CBE openly does not permit multi-use facilities, and I think they're missing a huge opportunity where they're now getting hit with the full brunt of the building cost because they have to pay for the entire structure instead of having pieces or substantial pieces of that structure be fully functional on their own today and in the future.
Thank you very much, Todd. Anyone else? All right, so that brings us to intermission. We'll take a quick 10-minute break and start up again at 20 after. Again, if any of you have questions in the audience, please write them down and bring them to Tara here, and we will go through them and pick some to go through in our second round. Thank you very much, everyone. All right, we'll start the second half of the forums now. So the first round is going to be what we call a how round, and I've looked at each of the candidates' platforms or talked to them before the forum to look at what some of their issues are, and I'll be asking each one of you how you would implement one particular piece of your platform, and you will have 30 seconds to answer that. So very quick rapid-fire response on that. You cannot use your poker chips in this particular round. We received five, and we've chosen four audience questions to go through after that in the next part. We had budgeted for two rounds, but we're behind schedule, so I suspect we'll only get through those four questions. If we should have time for more, we'll go back to the crowdsource questions, but I suspect we will not have time in that point. So we might as well get going again. So, for the first how question, Malik, you've said remedying debilitating facilities and infrastructure in mature communities, ultimately employing foresight on how to address the $920 million accumulated maintenance backlog. How would you do this?
Well, inherently, it's up to the provincial government to come up with the funding formula, as they do for other tasks that they have at hand. So for me, that $921 million has been longstanding and it's continuing to grow, which means it's been inadequately funded. So again, it goes back to the government to lobby inherently to ultimately get some additional revenues or reallocation of funds. And it's not just maintenance, it would also be additional technologies and educational improvements would be needed in the school system. I need another minute. No.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Greg. You've advocated increased transparency. How would you do that?
Okay. Well, transparency is lacking currently simply because there is so much behind doors, in-camera sessions, and they've legislated some of their procedures into this factor. Simply put, I would bring, unless it's a staffing issue, all other matters should be in public. There should not be any in-camera sessions, period.
Thank you. Helen, you said you'll be focusing on accountability, integrity, and commitment to community. How would you implement that?
Accountability and integrity and commitment to community is through honest, real dialogue and communication. It will be on my website, and I will be writing articles about the Calgary Board of Education and what takes place at these meetings, rather than just solely CBEs under CBE's control.
Thank you very much, Helen. Todd, you would like to see the focus go back to the classroom. How would you do that?
I'd like to see a team effort between school administrators, teachers, parents, and trustees of making a connection with a child. When a teacher makes a connection with a child, the outcome is amazing. Without that connection, the outcome is at best mediocre. We need to get the teachers to identify what's in the way to stop them from connecting with one student in a day. You get that, that's that student's lifetime set.
Thank you. Randy, you would like to see more home-delivered programs via internet. How would you do that?
Oh, it's happening already. My daughter is taking a grade 7 course in robotics at school. Her teacher is not a teacher. Her teacher is a facilitator. She has run the whole program where she's going to build robotics and do the things right through on the internet. We need to study this more, see the other programs in other countries, and use it here.
Thank you. Christina, you said that should be an emphasis placed on critical thinking, collaboration, and effective oral and written communication without sacrificing the basics. How would you do that?
We need to look at how we focus our curriculum and what's required by Alberta Education in the curriculum. The skills that we need for our children for future success are those three C's that I identified. In addition, we also need to look at adaptability, entrepreneurship, effective communication, like I said, accessing and analyzing information, and curiosity and imagination. These are the skills, and if we look at revamping our curriculum, then we may have an opportunity to do that.
Thank you. Amber, you've said you'd like to see all aspects of safety improved. How would you do that?
Wow, there's so many aspects of safety in 30 seconds. Yeah, I think we need to bring a bigger focus to safety in general. You know, we've got traffic safety that's happening this week. There's a lot of opportunity to have a look at safeties in schools. You know, our capital funding, I had a parent ask me about asbestos in schools today. That speaks to safety. If we can, much like corporations do, in a construction area anyway, safety is at the paramount, at the starting point to make sure our kids are safe.
Thank you, Amber.
Thanks.
Sheila, you would like to improve low graduation rates. How would you do that?
Wow, I get to continue my answer from before. I started out by saying that I felt we needed better early intervention programs to identify children at risk of leaving school early. That's step one. Second is we need to ensure teachers have adequate resourcing to help students that are struggling to be connected and finish school. Third, we need better ways to bring kids back that have left school prematurely. Those are the three ways that we can improve graduation.
Thank you. If anyone wants to see, I had selected this question well in advance for Sheila, just played out that she'd started already. Okay, so now we'll move on to some of the audience questions. So this will work just the same as the other rounds did. You can once again use your poker chips if you have any left. The first question will go to Todd and Greg. And this one is, so feedback from Ward 14 has indicated there's a lot of concern over traffic and safety, and it's the largest concern of residents in the ward. What would you do to improve that situation? Todd.
Yeah, no, I'm right here. That was excellent. Okay. What I would look at is adopting some safety programs, looking, there are police community partnerships, there's a community liaison officer that's assigned to the school, look at that, evaluate with the parents to see what parents are doing wrong, and wonderfully timed, I just had a document delivered by CAPSI that is working on a safety study on how to do it. It is a problem that we significantly battled in our kids' school, and honestly, the problem came down to the parents. And it does continue to be an issue, and it's how do you educate the parents, not worrying about educating the kids.
All right, thank you very much, Todd. Greg.
Well, interestingly enough, while I agree virtually 100% with what Todd has said, I think it goes a step further. What many of you may or may not know is that the city constantly undertakes various different traffic studies. And in the neighborhood that you're sitting in right this evening, a number of studies have gone on recently, particularly due to the TOD coming into Anderson Station. Now, the essence of it is that you cannot do traffic safety in isolation as the CBE. It has to be a joint thing with the city. It has to work with the city's plans. And the CBE needs to stand up more and have a voice, take that voice down to the city of Calgary and say, you're building the streets wrong. You're pushing the traffic through our neighborhoods by blocking thoroughfares such as McLeod Trail and or other roads of that nature. They don't even take into consideration what will happen when they dig up the road to put in a new sewer line and the traffic is diverted. Traffic is like water. It flows wherever it can. So you block it in one spot, it will go somewhere else. And by the way, it's going past your schools.
Thank you very much. Anyone else like to comment on this issue? All right, the next question is going to go to Amber and Sheila, and that question is, do you support the board's current governance model? Amber.
A minute and a half on this one? Okay, so I believe I had it in my notes here that I've been involved with enough community associations. I've been involved with enough school councils. Governance, at the heart of it, is a responsibility. It's a responsibility, and those that take it on should not take it on lightly. I can't say enough about how important it is to make sure that we are electing people that understand the great significance and the great privilege and responsibility that comes with holding that position. I'm sorry that I don't have enough time to fully address such a large question, but all I can say really, and Sheila will definitely speak to this better than I did, that we can do better in the area of governance, and I think the place that we can start is by electing people that understand the true responsibility that's placed upon them. Thank you.
Thank you, Amber. Sheila.
So there's a bit of a saying in governance that the best way to govern is with your noses in and your fingers out. And so what that really refers to is keeping a watchful eye over operations while not interfering in the day-to-day operations of the organization that you're trying to oversee. I would actually argue that our noses are out and our fingers are out too. We absolutely need to reform the governance process at the Calgary Board of Education. We govern through policy now, and what that means is that it takes a number of steps in order to intervene in situations of concern. What we need is three things in our governance. We need accountability, and that's over the basic fiduciary duty of legal concerns, proper spending. We need better representation of community concerns and ability to bring concerns forward
in a frank, open, and honest manner, and we need true leadership from the board. And that is about being strategic, about thinking forward about what the future of our school systems will be, and having the vision to make that happen.
Thank you very much, Sheila. Does anyone else wish to add in on this question? All right. The next question will be for Helen and Christina. And that question is, what is your view of the existing funding model for the CBE? Should it remain as is? If not, why? Christina.
Well, currently, the funding model exists is that we pay our taxes. The city collects the education portion of the property taxes, and then it goes to Edmonton, and then the province then gives it back to CBE. This has difficulties. There's a couple reasons why this has difficulties. At the local level, there is an inability to raise funds that are needed at the CBE for funding projects, capital projects, etc. So I would look at perhaps revamping this funding model. In addition, the transportation grant that it's currently exists needs to be also readdressed and looked at. These are two things that I would like to go to the drawing board and have that discussion with the provincial government to see if perhaps they would look into renegotiating that.
Thank you very much, Christina. Would anyone like to comment? All right.
Sorry.
You want to?
Yes, actually I do.
Well, sorry, I'm sorry, my mistake, Helen. We didn't, Helen still needs
That's
to speak.
What I thought. That's why I was coming.
My apologies. Helen?
As far as the funding model goes, right now I prefer with the way CBE is and the nonsense that they go through, I prefer Edmonton to look after it. At least they have somebody perhaps looking after it, because the funding model money is not being watched at all at Calgary Board of Education. I spoke to a caretaker a while ago. He had to leave because there was so much waste in the system, he couldn't handle it. So all I know is that as somebody who watches her, very practical and pragmatic, I'd certainly be asking an awful lot of questions, and especially in regard to the Calgary Board of Education and the head office. And how we had a building downtown, and now we're renting it. I understand the building was sold to an entrepreneur that was not, well, it is direct to an elite person in the world. And now they paid $40 million for it, and they want to sell it for $120 million. Why would we ever want to continue to rent the building that we are doing downtown? It's all backwards, upside down, and broken.
Thank you, Helen. Greg?
No respect for taxpayers'
Helen.
Money.
Okay. It's broken. The model is broken. Let me just ask you, is everybody in this room actually aware what the size of the budget is for the school board? Did you know it's $1.2 billion? $1.2 billion and we still have leaking roofs. The model is broken. The money was normally raised through your taxes. That model has gone away. I mentioned earlier $52 million, which the city is playing with. Well, frankly, the CBE should have been playing with it. The model needs to be revisited. And if there's resistance to revisiting the model, then you need to elect somebody that will go to Edmonton and say, give us our money back.
Thank you very much, Greg. Does anyone else wish to add in on this issue? All right, the final audience question we have right now is, I hear many debates about what it means to complete high school. I would like to know what it means to you to be an educated citizen. And that goes to the remaining two candidates, Randy and Malik. Randy?
Being a high school graduate is absolutely mandatory if you want any kind of career life and you have to continue on from there into college or university or a trade or whatever you plan to do later on. But with a high school graduation, not only is necessary, but the type of classes that you take and the understanding that you get as a person coming into society is important. I don't really have anything more to add other than it's just critical to get a high school education to be.
Malik, thanks very much. Randy?
To me, education at a minimum of grade 12 is imperative because ultimately how people are educated makes up both the social and economic framework of this province. To remain competitive as people, to remain advanced, to grow this economy in this province, we need a minimum education in grade 12. And to be honest, it seems like it's shifting over time to even a bachelor's degree has become almost, and the old saying at U of C was, it's the new high school diploma, and that's because there's additional criteria, qualifications, skill sets necessary. So to me, grade 12 would be the minimum benchmark for what means education. And I was actually, when I was going through the questions, I was a bit floored when the prospect of a grade 9 education and then a vocational school or something to that extent, considering the shortage in trades and so on. And I understand it's to fulfill a demand today, but inherently over time, the skills of those that continue to get education will overtake those that only received grade 9 education, and then ultimately that would hinder society and us socially and economically because they'd be missing the necessary skill set to communicate math, science, reading, and so on and so forth. So grade 12, I think, would be the minimum, and I think I'm all for additional post-secondary education. Thank you.
All right. Now, yes, go ahead, Christina.
While I definitely agree with my colleagues, I do think the purpose of an education is to instill in our children a love of learning. That is why we go to school. That's why we want our children to go to school, is that they want to be there, they want to learn. And so if we instill that lifelong learning, they will finish high school. They will want to go on, whether it be post-secondary, to trade schools, or simply just other opportunities to learn. That is the goal, is to be a learner. And I think if we instill that in all the capacities that our children learn, whether it be visual, tactile, kinesthetic, then I think we will have great society. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Christina. Would anyone else like to comment on this? And I would remind that it is the last question of the evening, so if you do have poker chips outstanding.
We can still use them for our closing, right?
If you so wish.
There you go. Can you see I'm
fine? All right. All right, so that will end that question. So I will now move on to the closing statements. So we'll start, actually, can I ask who does have poker chips left? Just Amber, Randy, Greg, do you wish to use them for your closing statements?
It's not gonna buy me anything anywhere else, is it? No, I'm gonna use it now.
All right. Yeah, just please show her, show when you're
sure.
Speaking.
Got it.
Okay, so we'll start from the opposite side of the table as we did the introduction. So Sheila, if you'll go first, please.
I'd just like to start by thanking the organizers of the event tonight. I think this has been wonderful. It's been a great opportunity to talk about the issues. When I look back at 2010, I recall there were very few issues that were coming up at that time. And it's a big difference in 2013. There are a lot of issues people are caring about, whether it's report cards, class size, spending, meeting practices. There are a lot of big issues out there. And it all goes to show how important our education system is to the people of Calgary. I've worked very hard for the last 3 years, and I hope that I will be re-elected to continue to work for you for another 4. To me, it's been about being open, being accountable, and representing my communities well. I've been a strong voice for you. I hope to continue to be a strong voice for you for 4 more years.
Thank you, Sheila. Randy?
Thank you all very much for coming out to this forum. I hope you leave with a little more information than you came with. I also hope that more people get involved in this election coming up, more people find the way to ask the questions. So I'm going to be out and talking with everyone that I can find, and I want you to tell me what you think a school board trustee should do. I'm completely open to any suggestions, and I hope I have a chance to do it. And thank you very much for coming out.
Thank you, Randy. Malik?
Thank you for your time this evening. I believe Ward 12 and 14 lacks a voice, an advocate which ultimately would work collaboratively with and engage and mobilize and represent the ideologies, concerns, and visions of the principal stakeholders and stakeholders of the education system. I believe I have the educational and professional expertise to make a tangible difference, not only within the wards, but would also that I would serve, but would also make a tangible difference throughout the entire public education system. My hope is, of course, to engage the stakeholders and ultimately address their concerns and convey their priorities and preferences and ultimately represent them for what they believe in, what they want, and serve as an adequate representation. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Malik. Greg?
Okay, last time to get up. The it's been an interesting evening. Interesting for me. I've listened and I've written many notes. But I will still say to you that the model currently is broken. The situation that we have with the CBE right now is you have seven voices, and over the past, we have often as not had two voices that have stood out, and that one voice, Carol Bassinet, has stepped down, and hence we six on this side of the table are running to replace her. The two voices have stood out, and they have not won what they wanted to win. Be that as it may, you need to send back, not just here, but in other wards in this town, you need to send to the CBE people that will stand up, that will say to the administration, it's time. Think outside of the box. And by the way, for those of you in government, don't think into another box, which is often the case.
Right.
You know, we have a situation where we are in desperate times. Let me ask you, where do you think the teachers are going to come from in 10 years' time? Do we have a stock of teachers that are all waiting, ready to roll into our system? I don't think so. They're not there. But in 10 years' time, there's going to be a lot of teachers that are going to retire. But the system is not going to replenish the teachers and add to the ones that we need. There is no plan to go forward and to be prepared for this. Oh, it's lovely, 3-year plan. You know, 3 years doesn't really cut it. You know, my little girl, Serena, is in a school. By the time the school was finished, we're coming down to 4 seconds. Okay, now I'm gonna use my chip.
That included your chip.
Which? Oh, it was with my chip.
Yeah.
Oh, well, thanks for coming.
Thank you very much, Greg. Helen?
I definitely will stand up to administration and have already. Like when Naomi Johnson took a holiday, I think it was in Australia, and a conference, and stayed there for a while, I mentioned it to her, and boy, did she give me a glare. Anyway, I also concur that the system is broken. When you vote for Helen, you will, Helen Mowat, you will be valued and you'll be respected, and I will be responsible and honest representative at CBE. Your children are important to me. We need a conscious, highly evolved civilization, and this can only take place by someone who themselves have experienced transformational change and understands the system. You can't change anything by the same minds that created it. Thank you for your support. I will update you regularly and keep you in the light, because the best way to clean a dark room is to open the window and that will allow the light in.
Thank you very much, Helen. Todd.
Thank you everyone for coming out tonight. I've highlighted that my focus is the classroom. I will be the unstoppable advocate for your child. If you want your child to have that connection with that teacher, if they're in school now, we need to get on it. If they're in the preschool, and I see lots of little ones moving around here, we still need to get on it. The next step is with you guys. I need you to start with voting for me on October 21st. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Todd. Christina?
I too would like to express my thanks this evening. I'd like to say that no other government expenditure produces the returns that education does. We pay more in taxes when we're educated, we use the healthcare system less, we use the justice system less. What we need to do is have adequate, sustainable funding. We need to support our teachers in what they do, which is actually to teach. And as the parents of society, we need to support the kids, because at the end of the day, it's the kids that matter. It's the kids that are worth it. And so as I look at my four children and the children that are here tonight, I would ask for your support, and I would like to earn your vote and work for you hard for Wards 12 and 14. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Christina. And finally, Amber, who has a chip.
Awesome. All right, so when I was asking friends and people who've been through this before, what's the forum like? People said, it'll just be supporters from each camp and nobody will be engaged. But looking at this room full of people and seeing how much you guys are tweeting, not only are the people in this room engaged, but you are obviously working at getting the word out to everybody else in the Twitter sphere. We have media here helping to get the word out, and we are showing that we are an engaged community. And so for that, I'd like to say thank you all for being here and being engaged, because that's amazing. As you can see by the panel, we have a number of great candidates that have the best interest of education at heart. What the quote I was looking for before is the trustee governance policy states that a trustee's role is to, and I quote, represent, lead, and serve the citizens of Calgary. As I said in my opening, I'm a mother of three, so I have a very vested interest in the future of education. I care deeply about this community, and I am prepared to advocate for the needs of our children. I believe that I bring the well-rounded experience, the passion, and the energy to serve this area. I believe that there is no better position in Calgary, and I thank you for your consideration on October 21st.
Thank you very much, Amber. All right, so I have a few remarks in closing. First of all, I'd like to thank the candidates very much for coming out here tonight and your preparations for today, and I'd like to wish you all the very best on Election Day. A big thank you to Civic Camp and the citizens who have provided the questions tonight, so everyone who either submitted tonight or participated in the crowdsourcing tool. Once again, I'd like to thank our sponsors, CBC Calgary, CJSW, Fast Forward Weekly, Fresh FM, Metro Calgary, Calgary Sound Rentals, Calgary Roadrunners, Calgary Association of Parents and School Councils, the Alberta Teachers Association, Students Association of Mount Royal University, the University of Calgary Students Union, the Calgary Foundation, and our host tonight, the Lake Bonavista Community Association, for their generous donations, both time, money, or resources. Again, I'd like to thank you all for coming out tonight to learn a bit more about your trustee candidates. And remember, Civic Camp is also hosting further trustee candidate forums for the other trustees, aldermanic forums, and also a mayoral forums. Remember, you're eligible to vote. Go to Civic Camp, look for the dates and the details. Good night, everyone, and thank you very much for coming out.